Since a young age, my life has been unusual compared to the others around me, even before the age of 5. At this time in my life, I watched my father beat my mother. I was no more than 4 years old when I realized what was happening. The worst part was wanting to help, but knowing there was nothing my little body could do. Time after time, she was hit or dragged across the cement. I remember bleeding from her knees, bruises on her face, and that she never wanted to go to the beach because she didn't want to wear shorts or anybody see the scratches. I was in the kitchen during an argument once. I was 4 years old. I remember seeing my father pull out a pistol and put it to my mother's head. On another instance, we're going home after visiting their family or their friends. And as I remember sitting there in the truck in the middle of the seat, I remember the Chevrolet door swinging open. My mother jumped out as we went down the highway. She was tired of it, I guess. So I guess she was pondering whether or not it was life or death she wanted to pursue. And at this point in her life, it was death. My father abruptly stopped to see if she was okay. The funny thing was, nothing happened to her, just a few bruises. This allowed me to see the decision that my mother had to make, whether it was to leave my father and my sister, Sam and I, fatherless, or to stay with him to ensure our family had, to ensure we had a family regardless of the conditions. At the time, I did not know which one I would prefer. But at the age of 5 years old, the problem of domestic violence was resolved because I lost my father on July 15, 1997 in a work-related accident where he fell 50 feet to his death. My mother took my sister and me to the hospital, but the doctor said we had to wait outside. He did not want to see the tragedy up close and all the details that were at hand. So I just stood there until my mother returned with tears streaming down her face. I often ask myself, what was his last thoughts? Was he scared? Was he filled with regrets? Or was he just content and accepted it? I know because of what the doctor said that when he came in, he was already dead, and there was a smile across his face. Everyone at the funeral home says because my other sister, Marley, who had died shortly after she was born, he might have saw her, and he was content to finally be with her once again. This was devastating. Realizing I was fatherless in the world at such a young age. One of the last memories I have of us when we were at a big carnival. We were going up on the Ferris wheel. And man, even then I was scared of all the what ifs. What if the Ferris wheel broke? So if we fell at our deaths? The funny thing is, that's ironically how he died, was heights. His last piece of advice he gave me, which son, he said, as I sat there, 5 years old, wondering what's gonna happen next as the Ferris wheel went round and round. He said, you don't have to be scared of anything. I just said, okay, Dad. At his funeral, I sat in the front pew and just knew, as crazy as it was, I just knew what should be done by me. And at his funeral, I told some of his family and friends who thought I was not understanding what was happening, but I did. And so I told them time and time again that now I was the man of the house. For some reason, I knew it that at the age of 5. I didn't know at this time how hard a promise of that value would be, or I did not know at this time, I promised that magnitude, how hard it would be to keep. I just figured I was the only boy in the house, and this meant one day I'd grow into a man. So I had to start now. I was stuck between trying to be a child who needed guidance and a boy who was trying to fill big shoes without any knowledge on how to. 2 years later, on the same day, I find myself at my mother's friend's house playing hide and seek with the other children late into the night. I was running into the kitchen as the phone rang. And Gabe, the guy who was watching all the children as the parents were at the bar, answered it. Then within seconds, a few tears ran down his face. I stopped because where I'm from, you never see a man cry. Seeing tears run down the old man's worn face left me standing there scratching my head. So I asked, what's wrong? Buying time for me to find out my mother had just died, he replied, my grandmother just died, or his grandmother had just died. I said I was sorry and continued to run around and play amongst the children. A half hour later or so, everyone returned from the bar, except my mother. She was often late or outside when everyone else returned, so this was not foreign to me. One of her friends told me and my sister we'd gone to my grandparents' house. I was not sure why, but I did as I was told. As we arrived, everyone was sitting in my grandparents' living room, and my sister and I was asked to sit on the couch. My Auntie Lane was the first person to speak, and she told it to us like this. My mother had went to see my father in heaven, and I was struck. I couldn't figure out what to do, what to say. But after finally putting what had just happened, I let out a yell, like a wounded lion taking his last roar. Devastation filled my whole body. I sat on my grandparents' couch. Tears began to run down my face. Knowing men are not supposed to cry, I couldn't help it. I was now lost in a world, kind of like Joe Dirt when he's on the railroad tracks listening to that music running through. But everything just went black, and my feeling was lifeless. My mother had been driving back. She had been driving to our house to get her boyfriend's medicine, and while she was driving, her boyfriend punched her. She lost control of the wheel, and the vehicle began flipping simultaneously, and she flew out the windshield, died instantly. Aside from a few scratches, her boyfriend Craig, there was nothing wrong with him. He's actually the one who walked to the nearest house and got the phone and dialed 911. There were two other passengers in the vehicle. The other male was all right, and the female, she had been tossed around and broke her pelvis and her hips. But here's a funny kicker for you. Within a few weeks passed after the funeral and everything settled down, I remember being shaken up at the funeral, but not shaken as I was about to be. The world worked like this for me at this time because the three passengers tried to sue me and my sister, a 7-year-old and a 9-year-old, for everything we had. So now, I'm at the age of 7, I have one more problem. Besides my mother's dying, people want to sue me and my sister. And without a father and a mother, I didn't know what I'd do. I was forever lost from this point on how life is supposed to go. But then again, who says there's a way life is supposed to go? I just had to figure out how to live without the guidance from the people who brought me into the world, which seemed more than impossible. So here I am, ready to take on the world. At 7 years old with my little bitty body, After months of bouncing around between two families, houses, and court hearings, I was determined I would be living with my mother's sister and her husband and their three children. I was content as I figured I could be, faced with the way life was for me now. As time went on, I began to understand more things in life and actually learned that things were not as they had seemed as I grew up with this family. My aunt's husband was an alcoholic. Not that I was not used to it, because I remember my parents were too. There were always parties and drinking. I knew what drinking was ever since I can remember. I remember trying to have a beer as I'd run to see the empty ones on the ground because I wanted to be like a grown-up. It was not until I was into my teenage years I figured out my aunt's husband, Greg, had been taking the good chunk of Social Security checks my sister and I received from the government. He got hooked on crystal meth. Not only did he blow all the money we had received, $400-something thousand, but he blew all the college money he had from his children as well. So now, we have no college fund or anything for any of the children to succeed in life. But he got arrested soon for writing bad checks. All the money he was stealing went empty, or the bank account that he was stealing went empty. I was around 14 or so when he got arrested, but I had no sympathy for him, then or now. My aunt was no angel either. She once left us, as we were teenagers, for 2 weeks. She had gotten into a bar fight and lost her job at the bank. So she realized it was just better to go with her boyfriend who was beating her as well, and an alcoholic too, go up to Arkansas with him and leave us children, all five of us there to fend for ourselves. So I kind of just laughed and told myself when I grew up, I'd be better than they were. So I'm working my whole way through high school. Not many friends, cause I didn't smoke weed, I didn't drink. I was kind of square, I guess you could say. But family issues at my house made me not want to be home anyways. All my siblings were either alcoholics, smoking weed, doing pills, etc. Me, I was just a skateboarder or an athlete. More than half the time, we were always fighting. But half of it felt like all four of the siblings was against me. Maybe it was because I had a smart mouth. Maybe they were just jealous. And I believe they were jealous because I had more ambition than all of them put together. Or maybe it was just I was an inconvenience in their lives. I cannot compare the feeling of hopelessness or loneliness I got when I was told, I hope you die, or I wish you never lived here. This happened more times than not. Whether you say it's children's words and they are harmless, at this point in my life, I had no one but them. My life has made me tough and made me learn self-reliance. I found my ways of not wanting to be home with these children by playing sports and working. Something that helped me besides sports and working was it my friend's parents. They always gave me support and encouragement for whether it was school, sports, or working two or three jobs. Not being home brought a smile to my face and joy ran through my whole body. I didn't have to be there. The people who watched me grow up in the neighborhood said I behaved better when I was at someone else's house. But it's because I truly believed they wanted to help me succeed in life. So there's three families that took me in and called me their own son. And for once in a long time, I feel like I mattered and there was someone there that cared about me. I guess when you look at it, it's because they knew what was really going on within my family or whatever you want to call them. And I was going to make it out one day, so that's why they kept pushing me to do better things. I thought of college, but had no real vision in mind. So during my senior year in high school, I decided to join the Marine Corps. I do not know why, other than it was my free way out of the place that I was dreading all my life, since my parents had passed away. But aside from that, there was no other reason. I just wouldn't do anything else at the time. I did the calculations, and I had nothing to lose, but several things to gain. That's why I decided to go through with it, even though each day I questioned my decision. But this one felt the most logical, and at 18 years old, I'm 18 years old. Once I completed training for the Marine Corps, I chose to be an infantryman. Because I had no fear of dying, I figured it would be better for me to die since my parents were already dead and my family never cared about me anyways. 2 months after I completed all my training, and then some extra infantry training I needed, I was told I'd be going to Afghanistan. I was not excited nor scared. I was just fine with it because I was not doing anything else at the time. A month before I turned 19, I landed in the Sandy Hill Hole of Helmand Province, Afghanistan. I got in trouble right away because of my attitude and constant challenging mouth. Why should I listen to someone who is scared of just about everything? So I was sitting on guard duty when me and someone else got in an altercation because of some words that we exchanged, which he misunderstood for what I said. Guard duty is an 8x8 box about 10 feet off the ground. I was on posts, that's what we called it, because there's nothing to do but just four wooden posts. And you'd be on post, or I was on post with another guy for 18 hours. 9 times out of 10, I didn't speak because he was either a nerd or came from a rich family. Imagine you're in a place that's 120 degrees, wearing 80 pounds of gear, standing or sitting for this long, 18 hours, watching out for people to try to kill you. This is where I realized one of the most painful things in life is a person left with their own thoughts, every day, all day, with nowhere to go, no way to distract your mind from it. It finally hit me that my story was one that was different, not only back home in Louisiana, but everywhere. I'm not sure which scared me more, my thoughts, or walking around, driving around, worrying about which second I was gonna get shot or blown up. The reality was, I figured I was not gonna die here. And if I did, so what? I sat there speaking with others about family and friends. Some of them was their first tour, and others their second, third, or fourth. No matter what amount of tours they had completed, you could see it on their face, the tired look of being worn down, but not only by war, was having family and not being there with them to share the moments. They miss birthdays, Christmas, Thanksgiving, all the things that matter when you look at it at the end of the day. They were husbands, they were fathers and sons, and ultimately they had people who cared for them. But me, well, I didn't have much to miss or anyone to miss me. But I did make it back because I'm standing here today. I made it back safely. And when I arrived back to the base, it was so nice to see people's families there jumping up and down and cheering. It was dark, so it was hard to see, but I know I have no one there. No one there for me, and once it sets in, I'm standing there holding my stuff with teary eyes, but I don't cry. Even knowingly, there's not going to be anyone there for me. I still hope, maybe, just maybe, there'd be someone, one of my friends or family would surprise me. You know, someone you knew or someone you loved, but no, not my life. Maybe not loved, because love's something that was as foreign to me as when I landed in Afghanistan. I mean, the feeling of loneliness that was present in my younger self as my parents left this world, that was bad. But coming home from, but imagine if you come home from a war, you didn't die there, and there was no one there to see you come home, no one to congratulate for making it home safely. I think a little part of me died. But once again, it was the worst it could get, and I never cried. I grabbed my belongings and walked to my room and thought, that's life, that's how it goes. Now, one day, I prayed it'd get better. I was just a 19-year-old kid who had grown up too fast, seeing the harsh realities of the real world. I realized I made it this far, despite everything that had been thrown at me. So for me, from now on, it's just to keep chasing angels and fighting demons.